Adam and I had been waiting for Finger for half an hour, and our patience had worn thin. We were meeting up at my house so we could all go ride to the outdoor basketball goals at the little church down Highway 36. We liked these goals because the rims were only 8 feet. Just short enough for vertically challenged white boys to be able to dunk. Just tall enough so that it wasn't too embarrassing. Finger's real name is Steven, but he earned the nickname Finger Roll because when we played on these short goals, he obstinately refused to dunk, though he was plenty tall and amply agile. He'd get his lanky arm above the rim and stretch out his hand, letting the ball gently dangle on his palm. At the last second, he'd whip his fingers back, moving against the ball's natural inertia, creating a spin that would dance spryly for a second or two on the rim and backboard before dropping through. It was all so dramatic. Finger roll got to be a bit too much of a mouthful, so after a while, we just naturally shortened it to Finger. The South's known for such great nicknames. I've known guys named T-Bone, Hangdog, and Gizzard, and two named Frog. But Steven is the only man who answers to Finger. Adam and I decided to split. Only seconds into our drive, we saw the source of our time impediment. Old Finger had been pulled over for speeding on the highway. He had that flustered look on his face that folks get after such an event. Head cocked to the side, face sunk down in his left palm, elbow jutting out of the open window, vacant stare. We pulled up next to his car to give him the business and to let him know where we were going. Our exchange took mere seconds, yet the policewoman did not take kindly to our short visit. She hopped out of the patrol car and barreled across the road, pointing and shouting for us to pull over. We complied. Though short, she cut an imposing figure. She was stocky, with one of those late 80s, early 90s power mullets. It was short and curly on top and long and straight down the back. I've since pondered whether she curled the part on top or straightened the hair in the back. Or did the cut itself just naturally produce such seemingly incongruent hair chemistry? From the passenger side, I tried to explain, "Ma'am, we were just..." She was in no mood. "Shut your mouth," she hollered from behind aviator sunglasses. "You boys wait right here," she ordered, before whirling back around to her patrol car. What began as confusion fermented into fury as Adam and I sat stewing in his car in the sweltering Arkansas August heat for 45 minutes as Officer Mullet did Lord knows what in her patrol car. When she finally strolled back over to us with a ticket book in hand, any semblance of deference, patience, or goodwill had long since evaporated. "Officer, let me explain," I demanded with a tone of condescension. "Don't tell me my business, son. You should know better than to interfere with police work." "I wasn't interfering," I fired back. "Ooh, you have a smart mouth, son. What would your mama think about how you're talking to an officer of the law?" "Oh, no, she didn't." Beginning on the playgrounds of kindergarten, boys are trained to recognize that bringing up someone's mama is tantamount to fighting words. Now, technically, I knew the answer to her question. My mama would have told me to hush my smart mouth and say yes, ma'am, to the officer, no matter how ridiculous the whole event seemed. However, I altered my mama's would-be advice just a smidge. My mom would think this is the stupidest thing she's ever seen. The word stupid just hung out there, festering in the thick, humid air. I don't know what came over me. Ironically, stupid was one of my mother's most frowned upon words. "It's ugly and demeaning and should never be used toward another human being," she would say. Adam buried his head into his hands. The officer removed her aviators and glared at me while she slowly ripped up the ticket and began writing a new one. Boys, I believe I'm going to make it mandatory that you appear in court for obstruction of governmental operations. She handed me the ticket. And in a fit of thick-headed delirium, mustering smugness from the bottom of the dark side of my soul, I immediately crumpled it up and tossed it on the floor of the car, saying, "See you there." Before the ticket had a chance to hit the floor, the police officer flung the car door open and ordered me out. She whisked me toward the back of the car and plopped my chest down hard on the trunk, spreading my legs and searching me in the process. I glanced up across the road at old Finger, who had his mouth wide open in amazement and delight. This is what the Germans call Schadenfreude, taking pleasure in the discomfort of others. Bewildered, I wasn't sure what she was doing really, and truth be told, I don't think she really knew either. She was ticked, that was for sure, and she probably wanted to introduce my smart mouth to the business end of her nightstick, but she settled for this roadside pat-down before she hustled off, visibly flustered, leaving us for good. Well, basketball was certainly out of the question. The three of us went back to my house to ruminate on what had just transpired. My first phone call was to one of my best friends, whose dad happened to be the city attorney charged with prosecuting us. I had to get ahead of this thing before it got even more out of control. City attorney said, "Well, that's a pretty fantastic story, Heath." I didn't like the way he said fantastic. It wasn't in the "I can't believe she did that to you" way. It was more in the "Well, you've spun a pretty fanciful story here, young man." He was going to have to hear her version to get to the bottom of things. A few days before court, Adam and I were to talk with him again. He said for the most part, our stories checked out. And though he was certainly disappointed in my behavior, he thought the obstruction of governmental operations rap might be a little much. Ultimately, though, this would be the judge's call. He said, "Heath," looking me in the eyes, "when you're called up there, just shut your mouth. Don't be cute, and it'll probably all be all right." He was right. Peering down from over the top of his tortoise-rimmed glasses, sitting behind an elevated, stately wooden bench inside the old courtroom that seemed to be cut right out of a sepia-toned past, the judge let us off with a warning and a lecture on kibitzing and minding our own business. I glanced at Adam, thinking, "This is too easy." Because of my nerves, I had failed to realize that the police officer wasn't even there. She didn't show. I took this as a sure admission of defeat. We left the court elated, high fives, chest bumps, reeling off the perceived victory. We'd shown her. That night at home, my mom overheard our boasting. She let us carry on for a while until we had pretty much exhausted ourselves with self-congratulations. Then she calmly asked, "What do you think it's like to be a female police officer, working long, often dangerous hours for little money in a male-dominated field, only to have a haughty, entitled brat challenge your authority with condescension and arrogance? And then to top it off, this brat uses the little political influence he can muster to get out of a ticket he probably deserved, casting doubt on your judgment in front of a judge and the city attorney, allowing that kid to feel that he can belittle another human being with no consequence. Now, how would that make you feel?" She paused, letting the rhetorical question fill the air. Like a deflated balloon rapidly losing its air, our imagined triumphant euphoria wheezed out of the room. She punctuated this lesson with words a son dreads. "You know better." My base instinct was to protest. But looking in the face of the woman who taught me about kindness, compassion, and empathy, I could only avert my eyes and stare at my feet in humiliated silence. Finger and Adam skedaddled out of there as fast as their legs could scoot. Though I never saw that hard-nosed policewoman again, my mother's disappointment instantly turned the whole fiasco into a metaphor of the power of an empathic mind, of the ability to see the world through another's eyes, and that ultimately arrogance is ignorance by another name. I'll certainly never look at a mullet the same.